Good morning. Hey, we're going to dive right into this. This summer, we've been reading somebody else's mail, but it's our mail too. The Apostle Paul had this huge impact on the world. When Jesus told his disciples to go and make disciples of all the nations, he wasn't even there. He was a later follower of Jesus, but he received the same commission, and he may have done it better than anybody. And he didn't just go start churches. He kept helping them grow in their faith, and he wrote these letters to them, sometimes to churches, sometimes to individuals. And God wasn't just telling him stuff to tell them. God was telling Paul to tell these churches and these individuals something that we needed too. In this one letter we're reading this summer, it's called 2 Timothy. If you have your Bible, you can turn there. This was the last letter Paul would write. He was writing from a prison cell, and he knew he was probably about to die, and he was right. He was about to die. And this last letter that he writes is deeply personal, and it's focused on an individual that struggled with being given an assignment by God. And I think more of you have an assignment from God than you think. I think you all have an assignment from God. If you're a follower of Jesus, he wants to deploy you to do something for what he's doing in the world. But Timothy, his assignment was pretty tough. He was a pastor of a church in Ephesus. It was a city that was really tough to do that in. He was younger. He had people doubting him. He had some doubts. Paul described him as timid. But Paul calls out some things in Timothy, and he really, in this beginning section of this letter, he wants three things for Timothy. He wants three things for Timothy's faith, and I think it's three things he wants for our faith. He wanted Timothy to have a sincere faith. We talked about the first week, because of your sincere faith, which means unmasked. You're not an actor. It's an authenticity that's derived from your faith and the object of your faith in Jesus. You're authentically faithful and reflecting Christ. And he wanted him to have a high impact faith, to fan into flame the gift God gave him and make an impact. And then this week, what we're going to look at is he wanted him to have a bold faith. And he shows us how. Like I said, it was hard for Timothy. We looked at this verse last week, 2 Timothy 1:7. For the spirit God gave us does not make us timid. I think this is a clue. I think this was Timothy's big struggle. Has God ever asked you to do something and you were a little bit timid about it? I think that was his story. So in verse 8, where we pick up this week, it says this. So do not be ashamed. Timid and ashamed might have been two of the issues he was struggling with. Don't be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or about me as prisoner. I think Timothy was getting some heat of saying, like, really, like, you're Paul's friend, and he's this great man of God, but he's in prison, and I think people were deserting Paul later. He tells us that they were. Timid and ashamed. Don't be ashamed of the Lord. Don't be ashamed of his message or about me, his prisoner. Instead, he says this. To timid Timothy, he says, I want to give you an invitation to join me. Well, that could be nice. Like what? Are we going out to eat? Going to Disney World or whatever the equivalent was in the Mediterranean at that time? Like, what are we doing? I want to invite you, timid Timothy, to join me in my suffering for the gospel. Timothy, jump in the pool. The water's not fine. I want you to join me in suffering. And I thought about it this week. This is, you know, sometimes when you read through the Bible, you read something a bunch of times. I read this. I used to teach this every semester in a leadership training course for college students. And I never thought about this before, but I became a follower of Jesus in 1987. And since then, I have never, in my recollection, thought, I'm going to go looking for verses about how I can suffer for Jesus. I've never done it. I've never had somebody come ask me about those either. 1990, I started out serving in ministry. I've never had someone say, hey, I've had lots of requests. Can you show me verses about, you know, overcoming anxiety or worry or fear? Or can you show me verses about how to, you know, just help with this area or this issue? Never had somebody come and say, I really want to know what it means to join Christ in his sufferings. Never had it. And the truth about me, and might be true about some of you, is I don't have as much grit as I wish I had. A couple of weeks ago, it was all tongue-in-cheek and just kind of joking around with him, but I met this guy who's a paratrooper in the Army, and he was on medical leave because there was a jump that went bad, and like dozens of paratroopers, when they landed on this training jump, had multiple injuries, and he broke his fibula, as did a bunch of others, and he was home, and I was like, wow, you broke your fibula jumping out of an airplane. Like, thank you for your service. I said, but you know, I can relate. This week I was moving a mattress. I kind of twisted my ankle. And I was joking with him. And he's like, thank you for your service. And I was like, man, I am so weak. I complain about these little things. This week I've been a little bit under the weather. So if I have to get some tea or something, I apologize. But like, I wish I had more grit than I had. But I don't go out looking for verses that tell me, that invite me to join in Christ's sufferings, that promise that if I'm going to follow Jesus, it'll cost me something and I'll suffer. I don't look for those verses. But sometimes those verses find us. And here's why sometimes they don't find us as often as they should. A lot of times when we study the Bible, we encourage you. We want people to connect to God, God's word, God's people, and God's mission. We think those are the four great connections as reflected in the Great Commandment, love God, love people, and the Great Commission, go make disciples and do that together. A lot of times when we study the Bible, we have a need or an interest or a question. So we get a concordance or we ask for advice and we start looking for those verses. We highlight those. And that's good. Do that. But one of the reasons here at Live Oak, we do a reading plan that's usually not a verse and it's not topical, but it takes you, like this last week, you would have gone through 1 Timothy, the first letter Paul wrote. This week, you'd be going through Philippians. The next week, it's Ephesians, chapter at a time. That's why on Friday mornings, I like to meet with men, anyone who wants to join me, and we'll read a chapter a week of a book of the Bible, and we'll just go through. Not looking for necessarily a need, a question, or an interest we have, but just saying, what does God have for us? And some of us have taken a buffet approach to Bible study. I'm going to read about what is kind of the big issue for me right now. That's good. Do that. But if that's all you do, you'll end up with a plate of certain foods and certain things, but not everything that God's designed for your spiritual diet. You'll have a Swiss cheese belief system, and it'll have some serious holes. And then if suffering ever finds you for following Jesus, it'll throw you into a tailspin. I think that's what was happening to Timothy. I'm following Jesus. Paul, you're following Jesus. You're about to die. People aren't respecting me. People aren't following me. People are ridiculing me. I'm afraid. Like, I don't think this is how it works. Let's be honest. As followers of Jesus, if that's who you are, many of you are, I'm sure you are, if you're here today, we don't suffer much for our faith here. But many do. For us, we're not really afraid of what people will do to us. We're afraid of what people will think of us. That's our biggest fear. But suffering isn't just something that happens when you follow Jesus. It's something he promised. I love to reflect on the promises of God. That's not one I reflect on a lot. Many have suffered for their faith in history, and many do even today. As a matter of fact, current statistics, every month, on average, 345 Christ followers are killed for faith-related reasons. Every month, 345. 105 churches and Christian buildings are burned or attacked. 219 Christians are detained without trial, arrested, sentenced, and imprisoned. It's not me. Really not us. We live in a pretty safe place to follow Jesus. And it doesn't mean you have to go looking for that. But at some point, some level of following Jesus, it will cost you something. And if you don't know your why, it'll throw you into a tailspin. And Paul tells him, join me with me in the suffering for the gospel, but you can only do that by the power of God. It's rooted in him. Remember that verse we looked at last week and started this week, 2 Timothy 1:7, one verse earlier. For the Spirit of God gave us does not make us timid. If you're timid in any area of your faith where God says, will you trust me and step out and say something, do something, leave something, whatever it is, if you're timid or afraid to do that, that's not from God. What is from God? The Spirit he gives us power, love, and self-discipline. And he gives us more insight into how to suffer if you ever do for following Jesus. Verse 9, he says, he saved us. And he called us to a holy life. And eventually what we realize is our life is not about us, it's about him. Holy means, it really literally means saint. What Paul told Timothy about him and about us if we follow Jesus is God's plan, his purpose for you is that you would live a holy life, that you would be set apart, purely belonging to him. That's his plan for you. So the question you have to answer is for yourself is, who has God called me to be? In Christ, you are called to be holy, which means pure. I know that I'm not pure, but I also believe that he is, and Christ in me brings that to my life. And it's not because of what we've done. Our behavior doesn't do it, but it's because of his grace and purpose. And sometimes we think grace just means forgiveness. It's so much bigger than that. Grace means he brings all the goodness of who Jesus is. What we celebrate with what we did with communion is Jesus gave his life on the cross, so all of our junk and sin is poured into him, and it's paid for, it's done. He's taken that from us. But he also, when he comes to our life, he brings with us all of who he is, his goodness, his righteousness, his purity, his holiness. And it's his grace, and that's his purpose for your life. What's God's plan for your life? That you would be holy. Because he's holy, because I know I'm not. And he says, this was the plan before the beginning of time. This grace was given to us in Jesus Christ before the beginning of time. This is something that was on his mind for a long time. This has been in the works. And it's revealed to us through Jesus. Jesus is the focal point. He's not just our Savior. He's our Lord. He's our leader. And we have to move off the throne to let him have that role. And then this key word that comes up this passage is this word entrusted. Entrusted. In verse 11, it says, and of this gospel, I was appointed, Paul's talking, I was appointed as three things, a herald, apostle, an apostle, and a teacher. Paul knew his role very, very clearly. And what we asked the last couple weeks is, Paul knew his role, do you know yours? What has God appointed you to do? If you don't know, figure that out. What has God appointed you to do? Because I think if you're a follower of Jesus, he's going to lead you to do something on his behalf that will make a difference, but it will probably cost you something. And a lot of time when people came to that fork in the road following him, when you read about it in the Gospels, people said, I'm not up for that part of it. But I want that blessing part. Can I have the good stuff? Well, the path there is going to cost you something in this world. Paul goes on to say, this is why I'm suffering. I'm suffering because I know what God asked me to do, and I said yes. And his suffering had him in a jail cell where he was about to be beheaded by Nero, or at Nero's command, the emperor of Rome. Don't let it confuse you if it costs you something for following Jesus. Now, let me be clear. All suffering that we experience in life is not because we follow Jesus. Sometimes we suffer for different reasons. There are different pains and sufferings in life. But there's this unique form of suffering that when you follow Jesus, he asks you to step out and do something, say something, be something, leave something, honor something, whatever it is, and it costs you something, and you suffer. And if you don't know why you are suffering, you start blaming or second guessing, or becoming timid and pulling back. Paul tells Timothy, there's no shame in this. He said, this is why I'm suffering, yet this is no cause for shame. Don't be ashamed, because I know whom I have believed. I don't care what they say about me. I care what Jesus, who Jesus says I am. I care about what he's called me to. He is the one I follow. And he says he's able to guard what I have entrusted to him. This is the gospel, that we entrust our lives to Jesus, all of it. We entrust everything to him. We entrust it to the one who gave everything for us and gives everything to us. And he says, there's this exchange. Will you entrust me your life? Because I'm entrusting you with mine. And Paul could do this because he knew my life is certain, my eternity is certain, my God is certain, so I don't need to be uncertain about anything else. And he is able to guard it. Paul is standing there being guarded by people who made sure that he did not leave. No one got out that wasn't supposed to go out, and no one got in that wasn't supposed to come in. Nothing went out that wasn't supposed to go out. Nothing got in that wasn't supposed to go in. There were guards there to make sure of this. Paul said, God's going to guard your life. And if something gets in that causes suffering, God is not surprised. And if something gets in that causes suffering for following him, God is not surprised, and you shouldn't be either. And he says, because I know whom I have believed. I know whom I have believed. He doesn't say know about. And some of the challenges in our faith is we know about God sometimes better than we know him personally. And what Jesus invites us into is this deep relationship with him, to know him personally, intimately and deeply. And he says, because of that, I'm convinced he's able to guard what's been, I've entrusted him until that day, until the end day, until eternity. In verse 13, he says this, what you've heard from me. Remember, Paul's about to die. Paul is this impactful leader. And a lot of times people, Timothy would show up and we've heard of Paul, we haven't heard of you. Why should we listen to you? Paul's about to be gone. There has to be a question somewhat in some people's minds of like, what's gonna happen? There were hundreds of movements in the Roman Empire. Very few survived. Sociologists try to figure out why did Christianity survive? Sometimes they say it's because they were unselfish. They suffered well. They cared for people well. They would not be dominated by the Roman Empire or others who tried to squash what they were doing or teaching. But what we know is really is the Holy Spirit. God did that. God said, I will build my church, but he uses his people along the way. And as people had questions about what would happen, Paul had to remind Timothy, there's a lot of people who are saying a lot of things. And he says this, keep as the pattern of sound teaching, but do it with faith, belief in God, and love. Love for God and love for people. You have to have both. Timothy felt tempted to modify his message. This is what Chuck Swindoll points out. He probably felt tempted to modify his message, as well as to stop preaching it, maybe even to quit, because he was facing a lot of heat. So Paul tells timid Timothy, keep running the race God has for you. Know your race, know your role, and know that only God can help you do this. But you've got to say yes. How do you do that? Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. You've entrusted your life to Jesus. He has entrusted something to you. The gospel, the good news of Jesus, the power of salvation, the truth, this pattern of teaching, all these things, they've been entrusted to you. This appointment, this role you play, it's all been entrusted to you. Just as God is guarding what you've entrusted to him, you've got to guard what God's entrusted to you. You've got to guard it. It's valuable. It matters. What has he entrusted to you? What has God entrusted to you? If you're a follower of Jesus, he's entrusted with you the good news about Jesus. What he says is, I did everything to secure it and make it right between us so you can be a child of God, but you are not an only child. And there are others that are on the outside looking in that need to know what you've experienced. Not just know about him, but to know that they can know God personally because of what Jesus has done. What gifts has he entrusted to you? What relationships has he entrusted to you? Where has God placed you? You know, we heard from Robin. Robin is strategically placed by God in Papua New Guinea. The world doesn't need another Robin. The world needs you. Robin's playing her role in running her race. Where do you show up on a Monday? I believe you're strategically placed there for God's good purposes. Have you ever asked, God, where do you want me to go? Or where am I already that you want to use me? What have you entrusted to me that this is Monday morning is my mission field? This is my place. And whatever he's entrusted to you, the good news of Jesus, the truth that you've learned as a disciple of Jesus, the relationships, the gifting, the everything, your resources, everything. What has he entrusted to you? And when you know what it is, guard it, but you can't do it on your own. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. God will always give you something to do that's bigger than you. It's not just about you, and you cannot do it alone. You can't even do it with great teamwork, although that's how God works. If you take him out of the equation, nothing works. You were created on purpose, for a purpose. Figure out what it is, and then ask God to help you guard that. Not to keep it to yourself, but to make it impactful. There's a lot in this passage that I want to give you some homework. I know it's summer. I know. But again, I want to ask you to read the Bible for yourself. Don't just take my word for it. The best thing I know I can do as a teacher is to teach you how to study the Bible. That's why I spent some time early saying, be careful of just the Bible study method of kind of going to verse of what interests you or what has a curiosity for you or what's a need for you or a question for you. Those are helpful. That's a great tool. But if that's your only diet, it's not balanced. And what I've experienced is when I just read through the Bible, it's amazing how God just kind of at the right time in the right place highlights something as you go through it. That's one tool, but here's another tool. There's a tool, you could take this passage, 2 Timothy 1, 7 through 14, and there's two things that are happening in this passage. There's these lists of things that God says, this is my job. This is what I'm promising to do. This is not your responsibility, this is my responsibility. I will do these things. Again, just an example would be, it's the Spirit God gave us. God has promised to give you his Holy Spirit. To live in you and through you. Okay, so that's, you put that on, what actions does God promise to do? What actions does God ask you to do? You go through the passage, you look at that. Boy, it says guard what's been entrusted to you. That's one of the things. And then you start making a list of those different things and you realize you thank God for that and you look to recognize that he's promised to do it and he keeps his promises. But then on the other side, you go, but this is what he's asked me to do with his help. So you put it into practice. The biggest challenge for many of us is we know a lot about God. We have information without application. And sometimes a tool like this can help you draw that out of the passage. This wasn't the first letter Paul had written to Timothy. He had written to him before, and he has a consistent message to Timothy. He says, you need to know Jesus. You need to know him deeply and intimately and know that he's in charge and every good thing is from him. He's the one behind this whole thing. And when you're a follower of Christ, he said, I want you to know your role and know your assignment. And as you do that, never forget God's role in this. Always remember what he's promised to do. And what he tells Timothy to do is guard what's been entrusted to your care. Guard what's been entrusted to your care. God has entrusted something to you. Someone to you, some place to you, some things to you. Think about that. Think about what this needs. There's so much here about our faith in God. Our faith in God, like our belief in him, our trust in him. What does this say about God's, to a lesser degree, faith or trust in you? That he would entrust to you something so valuable, like the good news. He would entrust something to you so valuable, like your family. Moms, dads, brothers, sisters, grandparents, cousins, whatever, whoever's in your family. I think you're strategically placed there. And he's entrusted people to you. But he says, I want you to love them well and lead them well, disciple them well, follow Jesus well in front of them and with them, even if they're not. What has God entrusted to you? That guard what's been entrusted to you. How much does God say, I'm with you. So you've got this. But if he's not with you, you don't. But he says, you and me together, I can use you to do something here that's bigger than you think and matters more than you know. That blows me away. There's three questions I want you to think about as we wrap up today. What has God entrusted to you? I'd encourage you to write it down. Salvation? Anything you've ever learned? Anything that God's ever taught you? It's never just for you. You're not meant to be a cul-de-sac. You're meant to be a conduit, that it would flow through the life of others. What gifts? What abilities? What position? Where are you? Maybe the question is, who has God entrusted to you? Who are the people in your life that are on your radar? Because they're on your radar probably because God says, I want you to have influence there. And it might be hard, but I want you to have a bold faith, an impactful faith, and a sincere faith. And then once you know what those two are, what has God entrusted and who has God entrusted, the question comes back to, what will you do with what God has entrusted to you? What will you do with that? What you do matters. God's given you some very important assignments, and some of us don't even know what it is. And what I want to ask you to do is maybe listen to God through reading scripture, through prayer, just reflecting on it and say, God, what have you entrusted to me? Who have you entrusted to me? And what do you want me to do? And the minute you sense that God's asking you to take a sincere step of faith and you feel timid, you're in good company. Timothy felt that way. And Paul coaxed him and encouraged him and said, no, that's not from God. Don't shrink back from a big assignment. And if you step into that big assignment and suddenly it costs you something and it hurts, don't let that throw you. That might be an indication that you're exactly where God wants you. Because sometimes it's going to cost us something. And I think everybody has an assignment. Everyone has a role to play. But you're responsible for figuring out what that is and deploying it well. Last couple of weeks, we've been talking about the Global Leadership Summit. I'm going to say something about it one more time. This is something we've been a part of for a number of years here. It's impactful on Live Oak before Live Oak even existed. And the Global Leadership Summit happens August 8th and 9th because we were a host site for years until we filled it up and had to move it somewhere else. We still get the lowest rate you can possibly get, which is $89, but that goes up on June 25th. One of the things I love about this is it will help you grow as a leader wherever you lead, because you lead from a cross-section of leaders, and it's laser-focused on leadership. The other thing I love about it is I love what it's done for me. I love what it's done for our church. I love what it's done for our community. But I love what it does globally, because what happens with the dollars invested here and the dollars they raise is they take it globally around the world. It's translated into multiple languages, and there's very few countries in the world where it does not go. Some of the ones that mean the most to me is the Democratic Republic of Congo, where my kids are from. That country is desperate for leadership. If the GLS wasn't in Lubbock, another leadership event will roll into town. That won't happen in the Congo. It won't. So I love investing in something here that grows me as a leader, grows us as leaders, but has a rippling effect around the world. The other thing I love about this is there are stories every year. It's not an evangelistic event, like it's not designed to communicate the gospel, but it always does. Because some of the leaders are pastors or Christians or people with a faith background, and God just uses it somehow. And I've had friends that have come that they were interested in the leadership side, but the spiritual side somehow gets stirred. But it's an event where I feel comfortable inviting my friends who don't know Jesus to attend, because one of the primary values of the summit is humility, that anybody can learn from anybody if you're willing about the area of leadership. But God uses this in a big way. And so what I want to ask you to do is if you have influence, and I think you all do, and you have opportunity to go, I would encourage you to go. Southcrest, our friends over there have agreed to host it. And so I'm doing my best to help them lead that well. But I could use your help. If you care about the GLS and would like to help me get others to this event, please come see me. But there's the information about signing up. If you sign up and want that rate code, you have to say GLS team for the promo code, and you have to say that your organization is Live Oak Community Church. If you want to bring an organization that's not Live Oak, we can get you a rate that's just a little bit more than that, but still extremely, extremely affordable before the 25th. And anytime between now and then, if you think of a leader that would be good to go to that, please come see me. I'd love to help you figure that out. Make sense? Yes. Man, Timothy was a guy that was timid, and I can relate. Because there are times where God asks us to do something, and I say, I don't know about that. If God's asking you to take a step in your life by faith, and you're timid, you're in good company. Not just because Timothy felt that way, but you're in good company because Timothy and Paul and many of us have figured out it's not us, it's Christ in us that allows us to do experience more than we could ask or imagine. And that's what God invites us into. Let's stand for closing prayer. God, thanks for being honest about people in the Bible and their blemishes. I've got plenty. Thanks for Timothy and Paul being honest and calling him out. Calling him to more. God, I pray you'd call us to more. And I do pray that many of us this week would engage scripture on our own, not looking for something specific, but only specifically looking to hear from you. God, thanks that you have something for us. Thanks that when we read the Bible, we read it with you because you've promised to be with us. And God, I pray you'd help us develop a bold faith that follows you fearlessly and faithfully. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.